I think I'll just start out. You all know I'm autistic. No speech until age 4. I want to just emphasize great teachers I had, starting with my mother, always pushing me to do new things. Great speech teacher, third grade teacher. I've got to thank Mr. Dion, the math teacher, for tutoring me in this office because I'm terrible at higher math. But the world's going to need us non-mathematicians. We'll get to that later. The science teacher, Mr. Carlock, who took a bored student and got me turned around, got me motivated to study. Some really great teachers. Educators need to emphasize the things the kid's good at. I was good at art. Well, mother wouldn't let me just draw the same horse head over and over again. We got to draw a lot more things than just horse heads. Love to build things, build on the strengths. Now, in my book, Visual Thinking, I discuss different kinds of thinkers. When I was young, I thought everybody thought in a picture the way I think. And if you saw the HBO movie, that shows exactly how I think. Now, there's a scientific word for that. It's called object visualizer. This helped me in my work with cattle because I got down in the chutes to see what the cattle were seeing. And they were afraid of things like reflections and shadows, coats on fences. Another thing the object visualizers are good at, anything mechanical. When I saw somebody had tractors on their hat, I thought that was pretty cool. Saw that, but mechanical things. Jobs with animals, hands-on, and mechanical things, fixing things like elevators, artificial intelligence is not going to replace these jobs. Your jobs are safe. I've been doing a lot of traveling lately, and there's a lot of broken elevators, a lot of expired inspection certificates. I've been checking them out. So the object visualizer is good at animals, mechanical, art, and photography, and absolutely terrible at algebra. I'm worried about that being a barrier keeping object visualizers out that we need. Now, your next kind of thinker is your mathematician, spatial visualizer. Patterns, music, math, chemistry, all of those kinds of things. Computers. And then you've got people that think in words. And the thing I'm going to show you is we need all the different kinds of minds. And they can work in a complementary way. As a visual thinker, when I write something long like my book, got kind of disorganized. So I had a great verbal thinker named Betsy Lerner who straightened out my disorganized writing. Okay, that's the different kinds of minds working together. Because visual thinking is associative. It's a different way of problem solving than the mathematical thinkers. And one of the chapters talks about Fukushima. We all know what that is, the nuclear reactor that burned up. The mathematicians did a great job of making it earthquake proof. Absolutely a great job. But then 20 minutes later, the tsunami drowned it, drowned the electrical emergency cooling pump, because they failed to put waterproof doors on it that would have saved it. And I talked to a mathematical scientist recently on a plane, and I said, would you have seen the water drowning the electric emergency cooling pump? And she said, no. That's where you need us non-mathematicians to say, hey, put watertight waterproof doors on this thing, and then it wouldn't have happened. Simple, old-fashioned, waterproof doors would have saved Fukushima. Now, the other thing is we're losing skills. Right before COVID, I went on some trips, and I went to a state-of-the-art chicken plant and two state-of-the-art pork plants. All the equipment came from Holland. And when I went to the Steve Jobs Theater, the structural glass walls came from Germany and Italy. Why are these countries making all this specialized stuff? Because in ninth grade, you can choose to either go tech or more towards the university. Now, the thing is, what you are here, I just learned more about your programs, all kinds of hands-on things to teach you how to do stuff. But then I was really shocked when I found out that the state-of-the-art electronic chip-making machine, you know, not potato chips. Okay, I'm associative thinking. I had a really awful dinner last night. I had a thing called flight fuel snack box on Delta Airlines. You see, that's how my thinking is associative. And the reason we're losing the skills to make the chip-making machine, even though it's based on mathematical research done here, is there's all kinds of mechanical things in there for us non-mathematicians to work on. I'm really concerned about the skill loss. Who's going to keep the power on? You better look at that substation over there. That thing needs a lot of tender love and care. And it's probably going to be by some of the non-mathematical people. We need the skills. People who think differently. And what made me really happy at the breakfast this morning is your president said she was a nerd, and she was proud of that. Now, the other thing is, I get asked all the time, how did I end up in the cattle industry? Because I came from back east. Because I went to my aunt's ranch when I was a teenager. This boarding school I went to had a 12-cow dairy. You see, that's exposure. Kids get interested in things they get exposed to. And they say, well, I tried this, I liked it. Or maybe I tried something out, and I didn't like it. Now, we got a lot of big problems to solve in the future. And you're going to need both the mathematical thinkers and my kind of mind, especially on policy. I just looked up a whole bunch of stuff on biofuels. And I got really interested that Virgin Atlantic flew a plane across, a great big jet, from Heathrow to Kennedy Airport. In fact, I'll be going to Kennedy Airport tonight. And it was on animal fats. This plane had a diet of animal fats and about 15% corn. Right now, we're putting almost half our corn crop into ethanol. You couldn't grow enough corn. And then when I added up the amount of pigs, and I'm seeing a great big huge plant I worked with was going to take a day's production at that one shift, the biggest plant in the world, to feed one airplane for one transatlantic voyage. So then the other bad thing that happens is if I use up all the animal fat, take it away from the soap industry, then they go to palm oil. That's really, really atrocious in terms of wrecking rainforest. Okay, wildlife people, you're going to hate that. You see, the chemist can make a magic box that can make just about any organic material into jet fuel. Yeah, I don't know how the box works. It's magic to me. But where you need my kind of mind is on the feedstocks, the thing I feed the magic box, pig fat, garbage, palm oil, whatever, maybe corn, maybe sugar. Oh, this rope could be made out of sugar today. You can take algae and feed it sugar, and you can make skis, snowboards, and clothing. I've been to the place where they do it. And nobody there had thought about the feedstock. You have to grow the sugar. This is where you need somebody like me to say, wait a minute, biofuels are sustainable, but only up to a point. Then it all of a sudden gets non-sustainable. Now, the last thing I want to talk about is doors to opportunity. There's a scene in the HBO movie where I walk up to the editor of our State Farm magazine and I get his card. Because I knew if I wrote for that magazine, that would be just fantastic for my career. That's seeing the door. See, an object visualizer tends to see something like a problem, like the lack of waterproof doors on Fukushima, but also see ways to solve a problem. The engineer, the mathematician calculates. I don't know how to make a magic box that makes pig fat into airplane fuel. I don't have any idea. But then how far should you push that? That's where you need my kind of mind. So I want to just leave you, keep this fairly short. The first step is you have to see a door to opportunity. I talk to a lot of parents of autistic kids. They're sitting at home. They're not getting out and getting jobs and doing things. Mother gave me a choice when it was time to go out to the ranch. 1 week or all summer. Not going wasn't a choice. 1 week or all summer. Got out there and I absolutely loved it. And I'll say to a parent, well, how about having your kid walk the neighbor's dog? Learn how to do a job outside the family. They go, oh, hadn't thought of that. They're too locked into the label. They're not seeing the door. So the first thing you got to see the door. They're everywhere. And then you have to have the guts to walk through it. I walked up to him and I got the card. Then I produced a good article. So first you got to see the door of opportunity. Then you got to have the guts to walk through it. And I think I'll just leave you with that. Thank you very much.